Hello aspirants, looking at current affairs for 5th Feb, the news items that we have picked up from the Hindu are these 16. We'll look at them in detail. The first one, I was forced into a deal with India, Jayawardene told US envoy. So this is then president of Sri Lanka during the 1980s when India Sri Lanka signed a peace accord. So this president J.R. Jayawardene had communicated then with a US envoy. And those communications are classified documents which have been declassified now after around 30 years. So in this statements which have come forth, he has said that Sri Lanka was forced to make a deal with India because its own armed forces were not ready to take on LTTE, which was controlling Jaffna, the region in Sri Lanka. So this was regarding the LTTE issue. So what was this LTTE? Liberation Tigers of Tamil Elam. How did they become so powerful in Sri Lanka? What was their objective and how did it end? So we'll discuss that along with this 1987 peace deal between India and Sri Lanka that is called Gandhi Jayawardene peace accord of 1987. So then Prime Minister of India was Rajiv Gandhi, and because of these initiatives only he was assassinated by LTTE in 1991. So what was the deal all about? That Indian armed forces would enter into Sri Lanka because Sri Lankan armed forces were not ready to take over LTTE. So that is what the statement says. So it was Indian peacekeeping forces, which were IPKF, which were deployed in Sri Lanka. So around 1,200 Indian soldiers died in these operations against the LTTE between 1987 to 1990. So LTT, first understanding what was it all about. So first understanding the history of Sri Lanka. So Sri Lanka was also a British colonial territory, and the colonial rulers, when they gave independence to Sri Lanka, that is Sri Lanka was earlier called Ceylon. So the independence came in 1948. So at that time, the Tamils were also present in Sri Lanka who were taken there on this island by Britishers. So these Britishers took them to work on the tea plantations here. So they had settled there, their descendants means they have been settled there for generations. So that is the descendants were also there residing in Sri Lanka. So they were Tamilians by ethnicity. So they're called Sri Lankan Tamils. There's something called Indian Tamils also. So those are new Tamils, Indians who are Tamils residing there. Sri Lankan Tamils are ethnically Tamils, but they have been residing in Sri Lanka for long. So in 1948, when they got independence, the Citizenship Act, which was finalized by Sri Lanka, denied citizenship to the Tamils and their descendants. So this was the first major blow to the Sri Lankan Tamils. Then in 1956, of course, it resulted in protests. In 1956, another step which Sri Lanka took was that they made Sinhala the only official language of Sri Lanka. So Tamil language was not given same prominence as an official language of Sri Lanka. So again, this created protests which resulted in even riots later. So after this, a pact was signed in 1957 and again in 1965 between the government and Sri Lankan Tamils, to ensuring them that they would be given regional autonomy. So these Sri Lankan Tamils are majorly located in northern and eastern parts of Sri Lankan provinces. So here they would be given regional autonomy, freedom in language and education. So language is important because that would be the means of instruction in educational institutions too. So these agreements were made, but then they remained only on paper. In 1970, again a new constitution of Sri Lanka came. Again, it made Sinhala the only official language of Sri Lanka, plus it made Buddhism as the only official language of Sri Lanka. So Tamilians majorly are Hindus and Christians. So again, this created further drift between the two communities, and this eventually in 1972 LTTE was formed, Liberation Tigers of Tamil Elam, who demanded a separate country for themselves, that is Tamil Elam. So that was the genesis of LTTE. Then coming to the peace accord. So in 1987, India-Sri Lanka peace accord was signed. Under this, the provisions which were that were given were the concessions from both sides. So it was believed since these were in, Tamils were ethnically belonging to India. So Tamil Nadu also, there was strong support for these Tamils in Sri Lanka from Tamil Nadu government too, and indirectly through the central government. So taking India on board was what Sri Lanka wanted. So it wanted India to stop supporting in any way to the LTT group and assisting in bringing LTT on the table and having negotiations, bringing concessions from them, the government being ready to give them regional autonomy, recognition to their language, and they giving up their separatist agenda, demanding a separate country. So when things had blown out of proportion, eventually India-Sri Lanka Peace Accord was signed in 1987. As right now in this news also it comes forth that Sri Lankan armed forces were not ready to deal with LTT. So after this 1987 agreement, it was given concessions to Tamil demands, you can see devolution of power to the northern and eastern provinces. So there, these provinces would also be merged, but later in 2006, this was invalidated. This has been provided through constitutional amendment too, taking into consideration this peace accord, the provisions in this peace accord, but still they remain on paper and they were invalidated too. Then Tamil as a national language is also been, was also been decided. This would be provided for under this peace accord. So in return, what would happen was Tamil militants would seize, Indian government would seize aiding Tamil militants in any way, and peacekeeping force would be brought in Sri Lanka to bring peace in this Tamil land. So this was the whole idea of this peace accord. But what unfolded was the Indian peacekeeping forces, as we saw, resulted in huge casualties. Many soldiers lost their lives. Plus, eventually, Rajiv Gandhi was assassinated by LTT, and it did not result into as desired. LTT did not bring in peace. It did not come to the negotiating table and was not ready to accept anything less than independence. So that effort failed. In 1995, Sri Lankan government passed a peace agreement, signed a peace agreement with LTT itself directly. But this peace agreement also could not last long. And finally, LTT continued to its old ways of violence. It has also been known that LTT engaged child soldiers. It was also one of the only terrorist organizations to have naval power too, because Sri Lanka is an island nation. So it was a strong terrorist organization. And in 2002, again ceasefire was signed, again did not last long. In 2005, LTT shot dead Sri Lankan foreign minister. So this was the last straw in the whole thing. And post this, the government started bringing in force against LTT, and this civil war initiated, which pushed Tamil Tiger rebels to smaller and smaller regions. Eventually in 2009, restricted to this small region and eliminated later. So this is regarding the civil war and end of LTT in 2009. So you can see the distribution of population too. This majority is Sinhala population, then Sri Lankan Tamils, you can see northern and eastern provinces, Sri Lankan Moor, another minority group here located here, and Indian Tamils are here. So that is regarding this issue of LTT. The next news item is, in Nagaland, government wings pay extortion money. So the National Investigation Agency has revealed that at least 12 government departments in Nagaland are paying extortion money to this banned terrorist organization NSCNK, National Socialist Council of Nagaland, Khaplang. So NSCN has various factions. NSCNK, NSCNIM is the other one. So with NSCNIM, Indian government has already signed a framework agreement for peace, find a solution to the Naga issue. So NSCN is also, the main objective was that they want Greater Nagaland, which is an independent nation of Nagaland. But then the factions which have emerged in this grouping, also some of them agreed to peace, talking, negotiating with the government and having autonomy within India rather than separate Nagaland being demanded, and some are more violent. So this is one of the violent terrorist organizations, and it was also behind this ambush in Manipur, in which it killed 18 soldiers in 2015. So it's complete violent terrorist organization, and this organization is being paid extortion money by government departments. So there is complete meetings taking place, negotiations taking place, and this money being given to this organization. This has come out presently in this NIA investigation. So agreement is there with NSCNIM, which is negotiating. Then the next news item is, AIDS body rubbishes government hospital's claim on HIV cure. So this is National AIDS Control Organization. It has said it will initiate legal and administrative action against doctors in this government-run homeopathy hospital in Hyderabad, which is treating over 10,664 HIV-positive patients with homeopathy pills. And this, they say, is a clinical trial, and they have also claimed that some of the patients have become HIV negative and they have cured them. So it is not, it is nothing like a clinical trial because it is not registered under clinical trial registration registry of India, and NACO says that it will initiate legal proceedings on this action. Then there is no cure for HIV as such, so the only the difficulties and the symptoms can be minimized, but there is no specific cure in the entire world. So such claims being made and patients being duped through this technique is what the NACO is going to tackle. The next news item is US suspends travel ban. So Donald Trump's executive order on travel ban from seven Muslim majority countries was ended because of the court ruling. So its enforcement was blocked by the court ruling in USA, and now US State Department has suspended this ban. The next news item is government in talks with BIS to upgrade helmet standards. So this is Bureau of Indian Standards. So talks are been taking place between BIS and Ministry of Road Transport and Highways on upgrading the quality standards of helmets. So the helmets which are used by two-wheeler passengers, so they are the ones who are majorly involved in accident deaths. So in road accidents, majority of the deaths are of these two-wheelers riders. So that is 34% in 2014 were on because of these riders. So it is therefore required that helmets of better quality standards should be mandated, and for this talks are taking place. So the government will come up with a specific standard which will be made mandatory. So what is BIS, we'll see. And other two provisions which are made to be changes, amendments to the Motor Vehicles Act by the Ministry of Road Transport are, it wants to increase the validity of renewing of driving licenses. So driving licenses for persons aged 50 years above is 5 years presently. So they want to extend it to 10 years. So that validity will remain for 10 years. Even for commercial drivers, the validity is 3 years. They want to extend it to 5 years. So this amendments would be made to Motor Vehicles Act. The reason for increasing the validity, they say, is so that less people visit the transport office. That is the reason. It will result in administrative convenience. So Bureau of Indian Standards, what is it regarding? Bureau of Indian Standards is a statutory body. It has been established under the Bureau of Indian Standards Act of 1986. It functions under Ministry of Consumer Affairs. And it was formerly, this organization which was there was Indian Standards Association. Indian Standards Institution, ISI. So ISI mark, which is still there functioning. So this mark is now under Bureau of Indian Standards. So this was a society registered under Societies Registration Act. Now this has been replaced by BIS. So this determines the various standards in the country. Then the next news item is Central Pollution Control Board assessing oil spill. So the Central Pollution Control Board is analyzing the oil spill along the coast of Tamil Nadu near this Ennore port where two ships collided. So it was Indian National Center for Ocean Information Services who has estimated, this is INCOIS from Hyderabad, this has estimated that 20 tons of oil may have been leaked, and they say this leak has been, the Tamil Nadu authorities here say that this leak has not been from the cargo because these were carrying oil. Empty BW Maple and empty Don Kanchipuram, they collided, but the leak which took place, this empty Don Kanchipuram was carrying 32,813 tons of oil as cargo. But the oil spill which has taken place, it says is not engine oil, is not cargo oil, this oil from here, but it is the engine oil which leaked in the collision which took place. So this is the Kamraj Port authorities, as they are saying, who are functioning these vessels too. So these vessels have been detained as well, and the assessment of this oil spill, how much damage has taken place, is being undertaken by Central Pollution Control Board. Ministry of Defense is in charge of oil spill management plan. So this coordination is taking place through Coast Guard, which is the authority in power and at the coast. Then National Institute of Ocean Technology of Chennai and Environment Ministry are also assessing what are the long-term environment damages because of this. So short-term, we have already seen that fishes, turtles have been killed because of this oil spill. So that has already been visible. Now further long-term damages because of this will also be assessed. So it says also the work has been covered up. It says 90% of the work has been completed and most of the residual work is expected to be completed in a couple of days. So even this has been criticized that how can cleanup be completed in such quick time, because oil spill cleanup, it takes a lot of time. There are various aspects which have to be taken into consideration, various regions. It's not just the coastline which has to be cleared, but other regions also. So this is how oil spills are tackled. So this chemical dispersion, this has also been used in this Chennai oil spill. Chemical dispersion results in the oil particles, droplets, these breaking up. So surface tension of these oil droplets reduces, so they mix better with water, they settle down and they can easily be removed. So that chemical dispersion, this has been undertaken. Another way is these booms. So these are floating barriers that are used to contain the spill so that oil spill does not spread in further regions. And these skimmers which are used, so these result, these absorb and remove all the oil. This may be sludge, oil and water which is mixed together then becomes sludge. So this is removed then by these skimmers. So all these initiatives have been taken. Also oil zapper, which is a cocktail of different bacteria that feed on oil. So this is a patented cocktail which is patent, which has been held by ONGC and Terry Biotech Limited. So they have jointly developed this oil zapper. So in the last major oil spill which took place near Delhi in 2010, this was effectively used. So presently also it can be used, is highlighted. Then booms, these booms which are used are like floating tire tubes, so they help in arresting the spread of oil due to water currents. So oil generally floats on water because of the high surface tension. So these dispersants which are used, they reduce the surface tension between oil and water. So oil dilutes and then it may fall down to the surface of the ocean floor too, so that it can be easily tackled. Then the next news item is panel formed to study Hajj policy, subsidy issue. So Union government has set up a 6-member committee which will study the ways to improve India's Hajj policy and look into the issue of subsidy to the pilgrimage. So in 2012, Supreme Court had ordered that this subsidy which is provided to Hajj pilgrims should be reduced gradually and abolished by 2022. So for this, how this should be done is being studied. Also, Supreme Court said that this subsidy amount which is used, rather it should be invested in education and other measures for social development of the minority community. So it's average around 650 crores, which is every year provided for Hajj subsidy since the last 5 years, if you look at the average. So Quran also, it was highlighted that it states that in this Surah Al-Imran that Muslims should undertake Hajj only if they can afford it. So this provision is already there. So government support being provided is not mandated as such. So that is why government has also decided that this subsidy should be better utilized. So a committee has been formed on this aspect. So also another point which was highlighted in this 2012 Supreme Court order was the jumbo size Prime Minister's goodwill delegation that visits Saudi Arabia every year at government's expense. So this should also be reduced. Rather than this, people who are already going for Hajj can be sent as goodwill delegation to the Saudi Arabia government. Then the next news item is Litchi disease report. Lancet makes amends after failing to give credit. So about this Litchi disease, we have already seen in the 2nd Feb news along with budget. So at that time, we saw that this Litchi disease, which is found in Muzaffarpur district in Bihar, and it has specifically affected children. Children below 15 years of age were seen to be suffering from encephalopathy. So encephalopathy is a condition in which functioning of brain is affected by any agent. There are different types of encephalopathy, like there is Japanese encephalitis too. So even government had initiated action to bring in vaccination, Japanese encephalitis vaccination in this region to ensure that such deaths do not take place. So healthy children, it was seen early in the morning, they would suffer from conditions which resulted in death also. So it was encephalopathy which was highlighted as the reason, but why is it being caused was not known. Later it came to be known that MCPG toxin, which is present in litchi, So these children were living near litchi orchards and they were consuming a lot of litchi in the evening, and they missed their evening meals and they went to sleep. And this dioxin, which is present in litchi, this impedes the functioning of the enzyme which is responsible for glucose, breakdown, metabolism, glucose. So this resulted in low blood glucose level, plus they were skipping meals. So this resulted in encephalopathy, the brain being affected, and even in some cases it resulted in deaths. So this was already known and this was detected. This is Dr. Jacob John. So he had published two papers in 2014 and one in December 2015, in which he had reported the similarity between this ackee poisoning in Jamaica and this Muzaffarpur mystery disease. And he had correctly pointed out on this MCPJ toxin present in litchi as the likely reason for the illness. Also, as a response to this, what should be done? He had also highlighted this 10% dextrose should be given within 4 hours of disease onset to save lives. Even this was recommended by these papers. So all these three papers by the team of Dr. Jacob John were acknowledged in this Lancet report. But then due credit was not given that to what extent these papers have worked on this aspect and how much more has the report been on. So that was the aspect on which the ethical issue was raised, and now Lancet has got in touch with them and sought clarification on the issue. So this is a positive development here on acknowledgement. About encephalopathy, which was the disease which the Muzaffarpur children were suffering from after consumption of litchi. So this was seen to be, it was expected that, it was speculated that this is Japanese encephalitis. So what is Japanese encephalitis? JE. We'll look at that too. So it's a virus which is transmitted from wild birds and pigs to humans through the mosquito, Culex mosquito, like for malaria and dengue, chikungunya, we know it is Anopheles mosquito. For here, it is the Culex mosquito, which transmits this Japanese encephalitis virus, which breeds, which is through the wild birds and pigs. So symptoms are fever, headache, nausea, disorientation. If it is left untreated, it can affect the central nervous system, leading to seizures, spastic paralysis, and even death. That is what encephalopathy is all about, that it affects the nervous system. So this is Japanese encephalitis, which is the virus through the Culex mosquito transmitted. So disease has no available treatment. Only symptomatic treatment is administered. Vaccine is the only way to prevent the disease. The next news item is defiant Iran to carry out missile exercise. So we are seeing the tiff between USA and Iran now. President Donald Trump speaking of imposing sanctions again on Iran. Also, secondary sanctions would be applicable, that not just no US company, bank can deal with Iran, but also no other intermediary dealing with Iran, then that would also come under sanctions. Means no indirect dealing can also take place. Means if an Indian company or bank deals with Iran, then that company or bank cannot deal with US. So that is called secondary sanctions. So all this we have already seen. Now the reason why these sanctions were imposed by Donald Trump was because of the ballistic missile which was tested by Iran some time ago. So this now again, Iran has decided to deploy missiles in its Revolutionary Guards exercise in presently. So this is again in a show of defiance, that if you put sanctions on us, we are still going to launch ballistic missile. So this ballistic missile test launch, which was done a weekend ago, now again another ballistic missile launch would be done after the sanctions also. So this is regarding that. So this was 29 Jan, the ballistic missile test done, and now 4th Feb, again another one will be done. So all these sanctions are imposed because Iran and Saudi are enemies. So and Saudi is a close ally of US. So ally, friends. So then Yemen is the country where Saudi is fighting against the Yemeni rebels there, and Iran is supporting the Yemeni rebels. So all that international politics which goes on, because of which US is imposing sanctions against Iran. So this is the Iran's ballistic missile, you can see, which it has tested. So these are the operational missiles under development, much further range. So these are the ones, Shahab series missiles, which were launched, test fired. Then the next news item is e-commerce in focus during Azevedo's visit. So WTO Director General Roberto Azevedo will be on a two-day visit to India. starting Feb 8. So during this time, what would be discussed is expected to be the new issues which developed countries are emphasizing on to be included in WTO ministerial conferences. So WTO has these ministerial conferences which take place once every 2 years. The last 2015 conference was held in Nairobi, and now in that was the first WTO conference in Africa, and now next is scheduled to be in 2017, end of 2017 in Argentina. So what would be on agenda is being finalized now. So Doha round of talks, that is Doha developmental agenda. So Doha ministerial conference, what was finalized has not yet been come into effect. So it has not been completely implemented. So Doha round is said to be still continuing. And this Doha development agenda was regarding improving trading. So WTO is a World Trade Organization. So improving trading prospects for developing countries was the major, you know, emphasis of focus area in Doha developmental agenda. So since these have issues have still not been completed, developing countries are against including any new issues in WTO ministerial conferences. But presently we are seeing that there is emphasis put on and a push given to e-commerce and investment to be included as issues in WTO ministerial conference. So we'll have to see what would be Robert Azadeh's point of view when he comes here, and what how would India respond to him. So you can see here, e-commerce and investment are the new issues which need to be incorporated. That's what the rich nations, the developed nations say. And New Delhi has opposed that no new issue should be added. So several Indian companies have also expressed concern, because even this e-commerce which has been emphasized on or given a push, they say that even e-commerce would help in small and medium enterprises coming onto the online platform, and they would be benefited. So everybody gets a level playing field, and these smaller industries, smaller enterprises would also be having benefits accruing out of it. But then what is not visible is that what is not put into the larger picture is that the developed countries are more, and their e-commerce websites are much more dominant, and they can grab a huge market if e-commerce is facilitated through WTO. So they are the ones who will be maximum benefiting from this, rather than the developing countries, because they are not even keen on this aspect, because there are other issues which have still not been resolved. So that is the point. So even Indian companies have expressed reservations regarding global, regional or bilateral pact on e-commerce, fearing it would favor multinational firms. So you have multinational e-commerce firms like Amazon, etc. So they are going to grab the whole market then. Also, it is said that India's e-commerce policy is not yet evolved. So there are concerns, issues which need to be understood and properly framed in policy framework, that is issues like data localization. So this data localization means that user data should be stored in a data center that is physically situated in the same country where the data is generated. So if data is stored in somewhere outside, a center outside, then there are fears of hacking and piracy and how regulation would take place. So data localization is an important issue. Then other issues like fake goods, net neutrality means net should be equally accessible to all websites. Everybody should be given a level playing field. So these aspects are also there. So these will be evolved after proper policies on cyber security, etc., framed by the government, and only then we can have a global pact on e-commerce. So that is what is being highlighted. Plus also e-commerce, you should know, this present push for e-commerce was given by two international organizations, ICC and B20, International Chamber of Commerce, and business associations from G20 members. So in September 2016, they had proposed that WTO members should consider launching new talks on such holistic packages of trade which will boost MSMEs. So this is the reason given, that micro, small and medium enterprises would be given a boost through e-commerce. So that will boost inclusive growth. So that is the justification with which e-commerce has been pushed by these agencies. So you can see the three pillars which it proposed were for this WTO package was enhancing connectivity and capacity building for e-commerce, enabling MSMEs to get goods sold online to consumers more efficiently, that is trade facilitation, digital rules to support online growth and build consumer trust. So these were the aspects highlighted. So WTO members in 1998 had agreed that no custom duties should be imposed on e-commerce transactions. So this is still effective 1998 onwards. This is regarding WTO, you can see. It was established in 1995, succeeded GATT, General Agreement on Tariff and Trade. So this was only an agreement. WTO is a complete organization. It represents 97% of world trade, headquartered in Geneva in Switzerland. So it's for liberalizing international trade, facilitating it, and the developing countries and the LDCs, least developed countries, are also taken into consideration how they should also be facilitated in international trade. So Doha Development Round, which is generally spoken of, was the round which took place in Doha, which is in Qatar, in 2001. So this round objective was to lower trade barriers. So this is still not implemented. Lowering trade barriers, making trade rules fairer for developing countries. Even GATS, General Agreement on Trade in Services, and TRIPS, Trade Related Intellectual Property Rights. So this has, these are also aspects which were considered part of Doha Development Round. So you can see since 2001, it had these several rounds later also took place to ensure that Doha agenda is completed, but then no development took place because there were differences between the developing and developed countries, between US and EU also, with respect to agricultural subsidies as trade barriers. So these aspects resulted, even in developing countries, it says exporters versus importers, there were differences. So no solution came forth on this, and the talks collapsed in 2008. The next news item is light purse for arms deal. So the budget 2016-17 has not done much capital allocation for purchase of new weapons and platforms which have been planned forward. So in the coming financial year, there are many Make in India deals which are likely to be concluded. Then how will the capital allocation funding for them come is a question which is raised. Then the next is regarding the rail budget. So rail project funds red flag. So this was the recommendation of the railway ministry to the finance ministry. The rail budget and union budget were merged for the first time in this present budget for the coming financial year. So the finance ministry then had highlighted that the functional autonomy of railways will continue. The ideas which were put forth by the railway minister Suresh Prabhu, many of them were accepted and included in the budget for the railways, but then some aspects were not, some ideas were not. Some of the critical ideas which did not figure are highlighted. This is formation of a holding company for all public sector rail firms. So this did not come forth. Only three PSUs related to railways were proposed to be listed, but this holding company did not come. A rail regulator to be established did not come. A fund for financing rail projects. Also, this was not there. Fund which was highlighted was for rail safety. For new rail projects as such, no fund was highlighted. So this was red flag. Means this was not put in the budget. So it says, while the railway ministry had proposed to announce a new holding company named Rail Holdco for its stakes in 13 public sector railway related enterprises, Mr. Jaitley only referred to three railway PSUs on the stock market. So these were IRCTC, IRFC, and Ocon. So these three will be listed, but the holdco, rail holdco, did not come into effect. Also, the other proposal which was accepted was regarding rail safety fund, which was also a recommendation of Anil Kakodkar Committee on Rail Safety. Rashtriya Rail Sanraksha Kosh of 1 lakh crore rupees over a period of 5 years, this corpus will be established. Then to redevelop 25 railway stations, this was also a proposal in the railway budget. The solar power plant, to south solar power to be set up at 7,000 stations, provide lifts and escalators, provide end-to-end integrated transport solution for various commodities, single window for coach-related complaints, and a throughput of 10%. All these proposals of Railway Ministry were accepted and incorporated in the budget. The next news item is 12th century sculptures unearthed in Kashmir. So several ancient sculptures have been unearthed from this archaeological site, Bij Behara, in Semthan village in South Kashmir in Anantnag district. So these are fragmented sculptures of Lord Vishnu. They are dating back to 12th century AD. Then there are also battle sculptures which are dressed for battle, riding elephants. So these have been recovered from this site. They belong to the Kashmir school of sculpture. So this is the archaeological site Bij Behara. Then the next news item is tribe offers clues to hidden wonders of medicinal plant. So this is a medicinal plant endemic to southern parts of Western Ghats and in Sri Lanka. This is Neocarex calycinus. So this has been used as a herbal formulation by Chola Naikkan tribe. So this Chola Naikkan tribe are a PVTG, particularly vulnerable tribal group in Kerala, and they use this for treating inflammations and wounds. So this can be used as a herbal formulation, as a modern drug for treatment of wounds, burns, and even cancer, has been highlighted by this scientist from Jawaharlal Nehru Tropical Botanical Garden and Research Institute. So this drug is a herbal formulation which possesses wound healing, burn healing, anti-cancer, analgesic, anti-inflammatory, immune enhancing, platelet augmenting, and antioxidant effects. So analgesic means relieving pain, a drug which relieves pain. So scientists knew about this miracle plant and calicinus since 1988. And traditional, this is a traditional medicine. So from that aspect too, it is important for exam. So during biological survey, this has been found in Ilambur forests in Kerala. And these leaves have been seen to possess properties which are wound healing. So this is comparable to providone or iodine, which is used for inflammation treatment. Also the drug diclofenac sodium, which is used for inflammatory activities, is comparable result is found through this use of these leaves also from this calicinus and calicinus plant. Also presence of vitamin E content and cytoprotective activity in the cell lines in this plant species, there are probabilities that can then be used to develop an anti-cancer drug as well. So the cell lines are protective, cytoprotective activity is there. So similar features are required because cancer is all about uncontrolled splitting of the cells. So this can be helped, this plant may help in developing an anti-cancer drug is also speculated. Also it has high vitamin E content. So that is here. Then the next news item is cancer drug may help regrow heart tissues. So researchers are developing an anti-cancer agent which helps in regeneration of damaged heart muscles. And this, in this process, they have found an unexpected result. So this, they say that many parts of the body, that blood, like blood cells, lining of gut, continuously renew throughout life. But heart does not renew. These cells do not renew. And heart attack causes permanent scarring that frequently results in serious weakness, and then a heart attack may prove fatal also. So this research which has been undertaken, so cancer drug that targets WNT signaling molecules, we don't need to get into further detail of what is this WNT signaling, but this cancer drug which is used, so this is the porcupine enzyme. So this porcupine inhibitor which is used by the researchers for treatment of cancer, so this is a cancer drug, has many predictable adverse effects. So negative effects are there, like on the bone, on the hair. But then one surprise finding which came was that this was the number of dividing heart muscle cells increased. So heart muscle cells can further divide and increase using this porcupine inhibitor. So it is an anti-cancer agent, but then it can be used in regenerative medicine also, is been the new find which is highlighted. So lab experiments have taken place on mice which have given this WNT inhibitor, porcupine inhibitor, and following a heart attack, it was seen that when this drug was given, the fibrosis, means the scarring of the hearts which were there, had reduced because of the use of this drug. So that is the regenerative medicine which can be used, an anti-cancer drug which is also a regenerative medicine. The next news item is butterfly find enriches Indian faunal diversity. So there is new species of butterfly which have been spotted in Arunachal Pradesh, and this was spotted, this is Limanitis rayleigh. So this had been spotted 3 decades ago by this naturalist called Roy. So he had spotted it, but then it was first recorded in India also at that time, but then there was not much media as such where it could be spread out, and no specific listing took place. So presently he has brought this out, that he had spotted this butterfly species plus also another butterfly species, Calarabia dibangensis. So this had also been spotted by him in 2013. So Arunachal Pradesh, you should remember, is rich in biodiversity plus also many new species of Indian butterfly. Local species have been found. Dibang Wildlife Sanctuary, it is rich in biodiversity again in Arunachal Pradesh, and other butterfly species too, like Tibetan brimstone, Ludlow Bhutan glory, they have also been located here in Arunachal Pradesh. So one is Dibang Wildlife Sanctuary, Eagle Nest Wildlife Sanctuary in Arunachal Pradesh, they are known to have butterflies, of such distinct species of butterflies. So what is important for us is at least knowing the important regions here, the wildlife sanctuaries and parks here in Arunachal Pradesh. So this you can see is Dibang, right? So Dibang is famous one. Then another one is Namdapa Wildlife Sanctuary here is famous. The eagle nest is located somewhere here near Pakhul Wildlife Sanctuary. So this is regarding that. So that is it. These were the news items. Thank you.